In this segment of our workshop, we're going to talk about the cause of the war. You can interrupt me at any time with questions or comments, and all I ask is that you raise your hand and they're going to hand you the mic so that we can all hear you and the video and audio can pick you up, and then I'll take your question, okay? Any questions before we start? All right. Everyone got a handout? Good. All right, my first question for you is, why did the cause of this war generate so much debate? Why can't we agree on the cause of this war? Do you have any ideas on that?
Oh, thank you. But perhaps because there were a handful of different theaters that the politics of the war didn't lend itself to rallying behind one cause. So maybe like there was some regionalism or sectionalism behind wanting to fight.
That's a great point. In other words, people in different parts of the country might have different reasons for going to war. I never quite thought of it that way. I like that idea. And it's a real diffuse war, so little wonder that people might have different reasons for supporting the decision to go to war. Okay, what else? Who else has got a thought on this?
War is disruptive to business and commerce, so I think people are object to that on that level.
Okay. So are you suggesting that maybe people were voting their interest? In other words, there were those in some sectors of the economy, merchants, for example, who might oppose the war, but others, for maybe equally self-interested reasons, might support the war. Okay. People have different interests. Good. What else? Okay.
I think one thing maybe contributed to that, our nation was young. Maybe our identity wasn't totally solidified, and so people's opinions weren't totally solidified either. So I think that could have contributed too.
So you're saying that the nation is pretty diverse?
Yes.
It's not yet a unified nation? Well, that's a great point. And I might supplement that by saying, I still think for many people the term United States was a plural noun. The United States are going to war. The United States are sending a minister to Great Britain. A reflection of the fact that people did think of the nation as 13, or in this case, 15 or 18 states acting together. I guess there were 18 in 1812. All right, good point. Let me ask you a question. Who made the decision to go to war? Where did this decision come from? Okay, one second.
I would assume that any decision to go to war would probably come with the leaders, meaning like the president, I think Madison, and Congress. Perhaps there were political pressures that were placed on him or in place on Congress to try to do something.
Okay, the president and Congress. Okay, who declared war?
Well, Congress has the power to declare war.
Yeah. One of the myths of the war, there is a widely repeated proclamation dated June 19th, 1812, in which Madison announces that we're at war with Great Britain. And people say, number one, the war began on the 19th of June. Number two, Madison declared war. Well, presidents, at least supposedly under the Constitution, don't have the authority to declare war. And all you have to do is read the first sentence in that proclamation, and what Madison says is, as of yesterday, when I signed the bill passed by the two houses into law, we were at war with Great Britain. There are actually two ways that Congress can declare war. Number one, a bill which has to be signed by the president. That's the way it was done in this war. Or number two, a joint resolution, and that does not require a presidential signature, and that's the way we declared war against Mexico in 1846. So the point here is we have a lot of people in on the decision, and they may have multiple reasons for going to war. And even if one person, a Henry Clay or a James Madison, if you conclude he played a critical role, well, maybe the single individual has a different reasons. The trick here I think often you have multiple reasons for going to war. The trick here is to establish the primacy of the reasons. In other words, you have to come up with some sort of interpretation on the relative importance of the different causes that may have driven people to vote for war. Okay? But it seems to me that's essentially we're talking politics. It's a political issue. You have a lot of people who may have a hand in making this decision, and they may be driven by a lot of different reasons. And that's certainly, I think, part of the reason this area of what caused the war is subject to so much debate. It's a contentious issue. And scholars, even today, do not fully agree on why we went to war in 1812, although, as you'll see, I have pretty fixed views myself. Now, I want to step back here and look at the larger picture because it is absolutely critical to understanding why we went to war against Great Britain in 1812. This was a byproduct of the Napoleonic Wars, a direct outgrowth of the Napoleonic Wars. Napoleonic Wars were the final phase of a long series of wars waged by England and France between 1689 and 1815. Essentially, they were contending, although they may not have known it at the time, for who was going to dominate Europe and the wider world. We sometimes call this the Second Hundred Years' War. England and France duked it out in the Middle Ages for 90-odd years. That's the Hundred Years' War. I think this has aptly been called the Second Hundred Years' War. Now, the final sort of phase of that, maybe two phases, were the French Revolutionary and Napoleonic Wars. Those wars began in Europe in 1792. In 1793, England entered the war against France. And thereafter, from 1793 to 1815, England and France were at war almost continuously. Not quite, but almost continuously. The French Revolutionary Wars lasted from 1793 to 1802. And then after a brief peace, we call that the Peace of Amiens, they resumed their war in 1803, and that lasted almost continuously to 1815. Those are the Napoleonic Wars. The War of 1812 was an outgrowth, a byproduct of the Napoleonic Wars. Okay? And you have to keep the larger international history in mind because it affects the causes of the war, the conduct of the war, the conclusion of the war, and the consequences of the war. Every phase is affected by that larger international strategic environment. You cannot look at the War of 1812 and simply zero in on North America, or you're not going to understand an awful lot that happened in this war. Okay? Fair enough? That's the big picture. Now, with the outbreak of the French Revolutionary Wars, or at least England's entry into those wars in 1793, this raised a crucial issue for American policymakers. Because understand, especially for the final phase of the Second Hundred Years' War, this was not a war that was limited to Europe. England and France were waging war all over the world. And that had a huge impact on the United States because we had a large and growing far-flung trade throughout the world. We were the leading neutral in the final phase of the Second Hundred Years' War, and frankly, we were making a lot of money as a neutral trader. Nations at war typically have a voracious appetite for imported goods, particularly food and raw materials. And we were happy to supply those needs to any of the belligerents. The reason they have such a voracious appetite is they have a large proportion of their young population that normally would be in the workforce engaged in military activities. They're not producing anything economically. And war machines have voracious appetites anyway. You know, you got to feed the machine. And we were supplying those needs. Understand that in those days, even though we were an agricultural nation, the success, the prosperity of our agriculture depended on foreign markets. And we had a large and important international trade. We're very much a maritime people in those days, much more so than we are today. And it affected everybody. Merchants, seamen, farmers, tradesmen, everybody was directly or indirectly affected by our international trade. All right, so it looks to me like by 1793, Hamilton's financial program is in place. That had really helped created that wedge between Jefferson and Madison, which would produce the two-party system, which doesn't really become fixed until 1795 over the Jay Treaty. But by 1793, Hamilton's financial program is in place. That issue is behind us. And I would argue for the next couple of decades, from 1793 really to 1815, the central problem that American policymakers have to contend with, and this is the Federalists in the 1790s when they controlled the central government, and the Jeffersonian Republicans after 1801 when they took power. The central policy issue that American leaders had to grapple with was this. How could a second-rate power like the United States protect its rights and promote its interest in a world at war? That was what I used to call the $64,000 question until my students started saying, why $64,000? So now I call it the $1 million issue, and I think they get that. Okay? Now, that was, I believe, the central issue that our leaders had to grapple with between 1793 and 1812. Now, the Federalists, who were in power until 1801, by and large pursued a policy of financial preparedness that was based on Hamilton's financial program and military preparedness, a small army and a small navy, and at least a rudimentary system of coastal fortifications. In addition to military and financial preparedness, the Federalists also pursued what was essentially a pro-British foreign policy. And the anchor of that policy was the Jay Treaty, negotiated in late 1794 and ratified by the United States in 1795. That really became the kind of anchor of our foreign policy for the rest of the decade. And my own belief is that that was a great treaty for the United States. It not only resolved a lot of the outstanding issues that hung over the two English-speaking nations, but it ushered in an era of Anglo-American friendship, which allowed American trade and thus the entire American economy to flourish. You look at American trade figures. Our exports stood at $20 million in 1790. They had risen to $33 million by 1794. That was the year of the Jay Treaty. By 1801, they're up to like $94 million. That's almost a tripling in the 7 years after the Jay Treaty. Now, a lot of those were re-exports, but nevertheless, it seems to me it indicated a vibrant economy. And not only simply a commercial economy, but an agricultural economy, because we were exporting a lot of our own agricultural produce. So those were the guiding principles of Federalist policies in the 1790s. Military and financial preparedness at home, a pro-British foreign policy abroad. Now, my own belief is that those policies served the nation pretty well, but the American people did not agree. And we live in a democracy, thank God. They voted the Federalists out of office in the elections of 1800. The Jeffersonian Republicans assumed power in 1801. They controlled the presidency. That was the beginning of Thomas Jefferson's 8 years as president, and they controlled both houses of Congress. So they were in a position to implement their own policies. And in general, I would say they were against spending money on a large peacetime defense establishment. They didn't like taxes. They didn't like armies. They didn't like navies. For a variety of reasons. They thought they were anti-democratic, they might threaten our way of life, and they were costly and required a heavy burden of taxes. So insofar as they could, they modified or reversed the policies they had inherited from the Federalists. The byword of Jefferson's domestic policies, I would say, was the term I would use, I don't think they used it at that time, was retrenchment. They were eager to cut back. The root of that word is trench. They wanted to cut back on government spending, cut back on the army, cut back on the navy, cut back on taxes. In their foreign policy, they were willing to pursue a more confrontational relationship with Great Britain. They were never happy with the Jay Treaty. They considered that a U.S. sellout to British interest. Jefferson once called it a millstone around our necks. So they did not consider that a good treaty. Now, the commercial and neutral rights clauses of the Jay Treaty actually expired in 1803, and the British said, would you like to renew them? And Jefferson, in so many words, said, not on your life. Because he considered that a bad treaty, and he really didn't think the British were going to offer us a treaty that we could live with. So that was those were the policies pursued by the Republicans. Retrenchment at home, and a foreign policy of confrontation with Great Britain. Now, yes, sir, hold on.
Well, it may perhaps be more like a comment. When you call it retrenchment, I may want to suggest reorientation. If the Federalists are looking east across the Atlantic because they have a vision of the United States as a trading and manufacturing and agricultural, but for trading purposes, nation, then their orientation and policies have to do or have to be oriented to appeasing our trading partners. But if the Jeffersonians are looking westward, they're reorienting the way the Republic is looking, not in terms of maritime trade, but in terms of self-subsistent farming in the West, then their concerns are going to be expanding westward, expanding the frontier, pacifying Native Americans. So. What I see here is not so much a retrenchment, but a reorienting the priorities of the country according to their ideology. And of course, their priority would be not appeasing the British for trade, but confronting the British and what they're doing in the frontier.
Okay, that's a fair point. And I agree that the Federalist Party tended to look east across the Atlantic. The Jeffersonian Republicans tended to look west. But you could not change the entire character of the U.S. economy simply by reorienting your policies. We had a large and vibrant agricultural economy, and that was dependent on international trade, and you simply couldn't dismiss that. And the Jeffersonian Republicans didn't. They simply thought they had a better way of protecting that trade and thus the prosperity of the agricultural sector that was so dependent on it. Okay? All right, let's look at the issues that ultimately, in my view, brought on the War of 1812. And these were mostly maritime issues. They dealt with neutral rights on the high seas. The leading problem was the Orders in Council. This was a series of executive orders issued in the name of the Crown by Great Britain between 1807 and 1809 that sharply curtailed U.S. trade with the continent of Europe. And under the authority of those executive orders, the British seized several hundred American merchant vessels in their cargoes. Millions of dollars was lost as a result of the seizure and condemnation of those ships, which were deemed in violation of the Orders in Council. That was the top issue in Anglo-American relations between 1807 and 1812. The British restrictions on our trade with the continent of Europe. And in my view, that's the leading cause of the War of 1812. Now, a very close second was the issue of impressment. This was the British practice, the Royal Navy's practice of stopping American merchant vessels on the high seas and removing seamen to fill out the crews of of their chronically undermanned warships. Great Britain was on a war footing. Its navy expanded rapidly during the French Revolutionary and Napoleonic Wars, and its need for seamen expanded equally rapidly. I think in 1793, the manpower, the official authorized level of manpower in the Royal Navy was 36,000, and it soared to, I think it was 112,000 by 1812. Now, at the same time, our merchant fleet was expanding very rapidly to accommodate our growing trade. And we did not have enough experienced seamen to man our merchant vessels. So we recruited British seamen. The British had the largest merchant marine in the world, and British tars were typically willing to take berths on American merchant vessels because for many the alternative was service in the Royal Navy, and service in American merchant marine was much more attractive. Number one, the pay was higher. Number two, the tour of duty was shorter. You only served for the length of the cruise. And number three, the discipline was a lot milder. In the Royal Navy, they maintained discipline with the cat of nine tails, flogging, whipping. Pretty harsh discipline. And the tour was unlimited. When you were in the Royal Navy, you were released when they released you. And sometimes that was only at the end of a war when the Navy was demobilized. And if you were considered a threat to run, in other words, desert, you might not leave that night, might not leave the deck of a ship for years. When your ship came back into refit, you didn't get shore leave. They put you on another ship that was headed out. And I think in many ways that was what British seamen objected to the most, the unlimited term of service. Anyway, given the alternative of Royal Navy service, it wasn't hard to recruit seamen to serve in the American Merchant Marine.
Didn't also at the base of the policy of impressment, didn't this create a diplomatic problem between the U.S. and Great Britain, because a lot of these British seamen would come to the U.S., they would be naturalized, at least by our standards, and Great Britain would say, no, once you're a British citizen, you're always a British citizen. We don't recognize that, which the United States took great offense to.
Okay. One of the great myths of impressment. Here was the deal. The British stopped American merchant vessels on the high seas, mustered the crew, and then you'd typically have some junior officer in charge of this little naval operation. This might be a lieutenant or what we would call a second lieutenant of maybe 17, 18 years old. And he would start interviewing the crew members to try to determine who was British. Now, the language differences were not as pronounced as they are today, and sometimes he'd make a mistake. Other times, it's a 17-year-old kid. He'd just say, you come with me. And you're an American citizen. You say, but sir, I'm an American citizen. Bosun's mate, give that man 39 lashes for insulting His Majesty's officer. And that's your introduction to the Royal Navy. Now, the fundamental problem was that British press gangs frequently impressed native-born American citizens. We don't know the number. Estimates from 1793 to 1812 range from about 10 to 15,000. And just from 1803 to 1812, which was the Napoleonic Wars, maybe somewhere between 6 and 10,000. Now, very few British tars actually became American citizens. The total number of foreigners between 1796 and 1812 who bothered, these are seamen, bothered to take out U.S. citizenship papers, about 1,000. The problem wasn't that British impressed those with dual citizenship, but rather they pressed native-born Americans, and there were a lot of British tars who'd lived in the United States, who'd worked in the American merchant marine for years, and they really were kind of like de facto American citizens, although they'd never become U.S. citizens. Now, the British did not deny the right of anybody to join the citizenry of another nation. They themselves naturalized certain people who served in their armed services for a couple of years. But their position was, even if you became a naturalized American citizen, you did not give up your duty of your original nativity. In other words, you still hold an obligation to the crown. You may want to become an American citizen. That may incur obligations to the United States, but you still owe your primary allegiance to the crown of Great Britain, and if we need your service, we have the right to call upon it. Okay? There was a question over here.
Yeah, just a question about the recruitment of British sailors. Where were these guys coming from? Were they already here? You maybe have touched on that a little bit. Were they already in the States? Were they in Canada? Would we advertise in Britain, hey, come to America and work on our merchant vessels? Where were a lot of these guys coming from?
The British tars, they were, you know why they were called tars? They work with tar. Seamen in those days were really pretty identifiable. They were sunburned. They dressed in a certain way. They had homemade tattoos. They talked the language of the sea, you know, sort of the shivvy me timbers lingo. They even walk funny, because that's how you walk on a ship that's rolling in the sea to keep your balance, until they got their land legs. Now, mostly these British tars were recruited in U.S. ports or international ports around the world. We didn't advertise them for them. You simply had a merchant captain. He's trying to fill out the crew of his ship, and he'll open a rendezvous, and seamen who want to take a berth on his ship will show up and sign the papers. A lot of that was in American ports. It might also be in ports around the world, and maybe even in some cases in British ports. That's where we got our British seamen. Okay, there's a question back here. All the way back.
What I'm wondering is, you said that the main cause that you saw it, the war being, was this issue of trade with continental Europe.
Yes.
And so my question would be, how did the U.S. political leaders believe that they could open up trade with continental Europe by initiating a land war here?
Okay. Well.
In other words, how is that objective going to be achieved? Because if the British, if their priority was to defeat Napoleon in France over there, even if they lost battles here, it wasn't necessarily going to make them say, okay, now we'll let you trade with France, because, of course, that was their true bigger enemy.
Okay. This is a great question. How are we going to defend neutral rights on the high seas by invading and conquering Canada? Well, the reason we targeted Canada was because that was the only place where Great Britain was vulnerable. We could not challenge the British on the high seas. They had some 500 ships in service. We had 16 in 1812. The only way we could pressure the British was by seizing Canada. Now, in theory, in principle, the idea was to conquer Canada and use it to extract concessions on the maritime issues. But how that would have played out, nobody knows. Would we have been willing to give up Canada if we conquered it? Would the British have been willing to give up these maritime practices to get Canada back? We don't know. That's counterfactual history. And our leaders were surprisingly mum about what they planned to do with Canada if we conquered it. And I think that was because they wanted to keep all of their options open. In fact, Federalist opponents of the war were so frustrated that a North Carolina Federalist, a guy named Joseph Pearson, got up in Congress in 1814 and said, what are we going to do with Canada if we're going to conquer it? Are we going to keep it and just give up on these maritime rights on the high seas? Our administration has never clarified its position on that. And he was right. So we don't know how it would have played out, but at least in principle, Canada was the means to secure ends, and those were British concessions on the maritime issues. That's a real tough sell, though, to Americans today. Tough sell to Canadians, too, and I'll tell you why. Nobody today understands the finer points of neutral rights on the high seas in the age of sail, because nations simply don't go to war over these issues anymore. But everybody understands a land grab. And the notion that we might have gone to war primarily to bag Canada fits into the larger history of American expansion. We've always been an aggressive expansionist nation, at least we were up until about 1900. And Canada always was a target, probably from 1775 when we first invaded Canada during the American Revolution to, I would say, around 1900 when we finally became a satisfied nation, had no further territorial ambitions, and recognized that Canada was here to stay as a nation. But I've seen an editorial in the Detroit Evening News as late as 1887 that said we had a fishing dispute with Canada. And even though Canada had been an independent nation for 30 years, the paper brought up the War of 1812 and the possibility of another war with Great Britain and said this time we got to make sure we get it right. And then there was a line in this editorial, when the next war closes, there should be but one flag flying from the Rio Grande to the North Pole. So here's a Detroit paper saying, as a result of our next war with Great Britain, we need to annex Canada. And the paper said that'll be better for the Canadians and it'll be better for us. So we still find that interest in Canada as late as the late 19th century. And everybody can understand a land grab. And so that has perpetuated what I consider one of the fundamental myths of the War of 1812, that this war was undertaken primarily to seize, conquer, and annex Canada, rather than win concessions from the British on the issue of neutral rights. OK? There's another question over here.
What you were saying about it's not exclusively at all to go and grab Canada. Is it possible, and this is sort of like my first point, that Bostonians or people from Baltimore to Boston didn't necessarily care about the Canada issue? Did they care much more about the seas and trading, where as you moved further west into the interior of the United States, they maybe were more apt to look at Canada as a desirable place? Does that make sense, what I'm asking?
Okay, so in other words, Easterners were much more interested in the maritime issues, neutral rights. Westerners may be more interested
that's
in Canada. Well, that's a fair point, but a couple of things to keep in mind. The Westerners alone could not have carried us into war, okay? If Canada really was our target, I mean, you know, it was sparsely populated compared to the rest of the United States. And there's another point. You look at what Westerners were saying in Congress, they're not talking about taking Canada because they want it. They're talking about the maritime issues because they blame the Orders in Council for an economic depression in agricultural commodities in the West. So even in the West, I think the driving issue here was maritime issues. Now, they also considered these British practices a threat to our sovereignty, and that rankled them. But I would say even in the West, the maritime issues took priority. My view is if there had been no Napoleonic Wars, there would have been no War of 1812. If there had been no orders in council and impressment, there would have been no War of 1812. You take those issues out of the equation, and we're not going to go to war in 1812 simply to conquer Canada. Even though there are some Americans who think we ought to and inevitably will have Canada, and there are also Americans who blame the British for the Indian raids on the Western frontier. But I don't think that's going to drive us into a war against Great Britain to conquer Canada in 1812 without the maritime issues. Those were of primary importance. Now, I mentioned the Orders in Council and impressment. There are three lesser maritime issues. The first is British violations of our territorial waters. In those days, a nation's territorial waters were thought to extend about 3 miles out to sea because that was the range of your largest shore batteries. Those were your waters. They were an extension of your territory, an extension of your sovereignty. Foreign warships were not supposed to conduct searches and seizures within your waters. That violated your sovereignty. Well, sometimes British warships did. They might search American merchant vessels or impress from American merchant vessels inside American waters. They might seize a French privateer or small warship that had taken refuge in American waters. Now, sometimes this was an accident. Who in those days knew where the 3-mile limit began? I mean, you're basically making an educated guess, and maybe you got a jagged coast, and a British ship, a warship chasing a French privateer. Maybe the French privateer got into the edge of American waters. British ship would look and say, that doesn't look like 3 miles to me, and seize the ship. But sometimes it was not an accident. You're chasing a French privateer for a couple of days and you don't want to give up the chase. Or a warship that has lost half of its crew to desertion in American port moves out to the edge of our territorial waters and stops the first merchant vessel it sees, the first 10 merchant vessel it sees, and starts pulling off seamen. And maybe some of that impressment takes place within our territorial waters. All right, another question.
Oh, thank you. Yes, just out of curiosity, during this period of time, weren't the French like occasionally seizing American ships too? And if so, why weren't like the Democrat, Republican, you know, in Congress and in government, you know, targeting them as well as the British?
All right. Why weren't we targeting the French, who were also committing depredations on our commerce? That was precisely the question that Federalist opponents of the War of 1812 kept asking. And if you look at the numbers, the French seized about as many merchant vessels and cargoes as the British under their own restrictive decrees, which were called the Continental Decrees. These were issued by Napoleon in 1806, 1807. And the British argued they were merely responding to the French Continental Decrees. Both nations targeted American commerce. And the Federalists wanted to know why we weren't going to war against France instead. In fact, there was talk about what at the time was called a triangular war, a declaration of war by the United States, or maybe just a limited maritime war that targeted both the British and the French in 1812. But that would have been a pretty tall order, to go to war against the two most powerful nations in the world. And even if you limit it to reprisals on the high seas, it means you can't use the ports of the other nation as a base of operation for your warships and your privateers. The advantage of singling out Great Britain or France was your warships and privateers can use the ports of the other nation to sail from. If you're at war with both, you're not going to have access to the ports of either one. Okay. Question in the back here.
Couldn't it be another interesting way of looking at it then, when we said that the main issues would be the trade issues and, of course, impressment? But couldn't you also put underneath that also the British intransigence and allowing our westward expansion, all underneath an umbrella of a real cause being the overarching cause with those underneath it being that the U.S. was being denied their place in the sun by the British, and there was a lack of respect there? So wasn't underneath it all, couldn't the driving force here that the Americans felt that they didn't have proper respect from the British? And isn't that, I know that's a little bit more intangible, but the sense of not having the respect of the British, isn't that kind of a driving force?
Well, that's true. The British did not, according to the Jeffersonian Republicans, accord us proper respect. And these practices were a fundamental threat to American sovereignty. So I accept that argument, but that argument turns first and foremost on the orders in council and impressment. No orders in council, no impressment, we can put up with these lesser encroachments on our rights. They do not offer a fundamental challenge to American sovereignty. I think that was the perception at the time. Okay? All right, now in addition to the orders in council and impressment and violation of our territorial waters, two other maritime issues that were of some note were abuses of naval blockades. Under international law, a naval power like Great Britain could blockade the coast of its enemy, which it did. And we argued the British didn't always comply with international law in maintaining their blockade of French ports and harbors and the ports and harbors of France's allies. And finally, there was definition of contraband. It was the accepted right of a nation at war to stop neutral vessels on the high seas to see if there was any contraband headed for the enemy. If there was, that could be confiscated without compensation. The problem here was international law did not clearly define what constituted contraband. The United States argued for a very narrow definition, those things that could actually be used in battle. Cannons, gunpowder, muskets, rifles, swords. War material, in effect, munitions. The British had a much more expansive definition. They argued that anything that might be used to outfit a warship was contraband. Masts, ship timber, tar, turpentine, canvas that might be used in the sails. They sometimes argued that food was contraband and might be confiscated. And there were a few occasions when they argued that hard cash, gold and silver coin or bullion, was contraband and could be seized. So that was one of the minor maritime issues that generated controversy, what constituted contraband. Now, how were the Jeffersonian Republicans to deal with these issues between the United States and Great Britain? Well, they would have said our only options were submission and war in 1812. There was another option, that was accommodation. That was the policy pursued by the Federalists with the Jay Treaty of 1794. And the Jeffersonian Republicans actually had an opportunity to renew that treaty on even more favorable terms with the United States. Two American agents in London, James Monroe, the future president, and William Pinckney, who was a Baltimore lawyer, negotiated a successor to the Jay Treaty on the last day of 1806. We call this the Monroe-Pinckney Treaty. Now, I've compared that treaty with the Jay Treaty clause for clause, and it looks to me like it was a better deal for the US than the Jay Treaty, at least in the realm of commerce and neutral rights. But because the British were unwilling to give up the practice of impressment in that treaty, when Jefferson got it back, he refused to submit it to the Senate. He sent it back for renegotiation. Well, that was a death warrant for the treaty. The British had already made all the concessions they were going to make. So in effect, Jefferson killed the treaty. It seems to me, was a great turning point in the age of Jefferson, although it receives little attention in the textbooks, because I think, and this is a suspicion, we're dealing with counterfactual history here, not what happened, but what might have happened. I think if we had ratified that treaty, we had a fair chance of taking a road that led to peace and prosperity. Instead, we took another road, one that led to trade restrictions and war. The reason Jefferson was willing to deep six this treaty is he felt that there were other means at our disposal to get what we wanted from the British. His decision really rested on two fundamental beliefs. Number one, the British were going to lose that war in Europe. And once they were laid low by defeat at the hands of Napoleonic France, the smaller naval powers on the continent were going to demand that the British acknowledge a very broad definition of neutral rights. And we would profit from that broad definition. So why settle for a half a loaf now in the Monroe-Pinckney Treaty when once the British have lost the war in Europe, we'll get a much more expansive definition of neutral rights from the British? Well, that expectation on Jefferson's part was dead wrong. Turned out the British were not going to lose the Napoleonic Wars. They won them. The other driving assumption in Jefferson's decision to deep six this treaty was the belief that we held a trump card in our relationship with all the great powers of Europe, but especially with the British, and that was our trade. They needed us more than we needed them. The British relied on us for raw materials, particularly food, and for markets for their manufactured goods. And if we cut off our trade with Great Britain, we could bring her to her knees. Now, in 1806, we actually adopted a limited non-importation act as a kind of warning or a threat, telling the British if they did not make significant concessions in the Monroe-Pinckney negotiations then underway, they could expect more of the same. That law was repeatedly suspended until late 1807, when it was joined by a much more comprehensive and controversial trade restriction. That was Jefferson's embargo. That was essentially a non-exportation law. It prohibited American ships and goods from leaving port. It was in force for 15 months. It wrecked American prosperity and cut sharply into government revenue without winning any concessions from the British. In a secondary fashion, it also targeted France, and France didn't make any concessions either. In 1809, the embargo and the non-importation acts were replaced by a non-intercourse act, which reopened trade with the rest of the world but prohibited all trade with England, France, and their colonies. That measure didn't work either. It was repealed in 1810, and for about a year we had free trade with Europe. But then in 1811, we adopted a new and more comprehensive non-importation law against Great Britain that prohibited all British imports. Neither British ships nor British goods were welcome in American ports under that law. And that was the last major trade restriction that was in force during the pre-war period. Now, collectively, we call this series of trade restrictions, beginning with the Partial Non-Importation Act of 1806 and ending with the Full Non-Importation Act of 1811, collectively we call those measures the restrictive system. They restricted our trade with Great Britain and, on occasion, France, and sometimes even with the rest of the world. We were using our trade as an instrument of foreign policy. We were cutting off trade with the two leading belligerents in the hope of forcing them to show greater respect for our neutral rights on the high seas. The question here.
One of the things I find confusing about the Jefferson's position with this is, one, given the British dominance on the high seas, how did he expect that American trade was going to be protected when we cut off our trade with them? I mean, if they wanted to, conceivably, they could just do what they were doing before in seizing vessels and getting the material anyways. But my primary question is, what did they expect to replace this trade with? Our whole economy was based on the maritime trade, even the agriculture. If we stopped trading with Britain, which is where most of our money was coming from, in France, who do we sell to? Who do we make money from?
All right, these are two great points. Number one, even without a large navy afloat, we figured if we cut off trade with Great Britain, there's no way they have access to American markets or American raw materials and food. And that's going to bring them to their knees. And they can't simply, you can't send a navy over and seize our agricultural produce. How are you going to do that? Probably not very, very well. And you can't force open American markets with a navy. That's not going to work. Your other point, I think, is a good one. How was our economy going to do under these trade restrictions? And it did very badly. In my view, you ask the question, who destroyed American prosperity in the age of Jefferson? It wasn't the Brits. It wasn't the French. It was our own government with this ill-conceived policy of trade restrictions. Now, the reason Jefferson and Madison were so confident of these policies, and Madison was probably the chief architect of the restrictive system, was they had sort of fond of hazy memories of how these non-importation, non-exportation, and non-consumption agreements had worked in the colonial period. In the mid-1760s, when the British adopted the Stamp Act, we halted trade with Great Britain. And the British repealed the Stamp Act. Well, that was the key. Now, we know as scholars today, as historians, that the British did not repeal the Stamp Act because of American economic pressure. They had other internal reasons for doing it. But Jefferson and Madison didn't understand that. They thought we had a real powerful weapon in our trade. But it turned out we didn't. And the restrictive system was a failure. It did not work. It was sold to the American people in part as an alternative to war, a peaceful alternative to war. And that's very attractive. I'll tell you, the trade restrictions of the early national period discredited the whole idea of economic coercion for more than a century. But we have revived trade restrictions in this century as an instrument of foreign policy. It's more attractive than war, doesn't cost as much, no lives are put in danger. So you'll find us all the time closing our trade with foreign nations to try to force them to do our bidding. They don't work. Trade restrictions almost never work. Best modern case, in 1961, we slapped a trade embargo on Cuba to bring down the communist regime. That was more than a half century ago. That regime is still there.
But we have one case.
Pardon me?
But we have one case. Still working.
Still working. All right, that is a foreign policy initiative that is still in progress. Fair enough. Okay. There were, in my judgment, these maritime issues were the driving force behind the decision to go to war, but I want to at least mention some of the other issues that I would call minor issues. Territorial expansion was a minor cause of the War of 1812. There were those who wanted to seize, conquer, and annex Canada. And by the way, you and I, looking back at history, assume American expansion headed west and south, but people in the early national period didn't see it that way. They assumed American expansion was going to head north as well. And it really wasn't until the late 19th century that Americans finally, I think, realized we were not likely to acquire Canada. So there was this desire to seize Canada, in part to acquire territory, but probably more importantly, to put an end to Indian depredations on the French frontier, on the Western frontier, which we blamed on the British, because they were arming and supplying the Indians. In point of fact, the British were trying to hold back their Indian allies. They armed and supplied the Indians as allies because they knew they would need a counterweight to the United States if war ever erupted. There were, in 1812, 7.7 million people in the United States, 500,000 in Canada. That gave the United States a 15-to-1 population advantage. So the British cultivated Indian allies by supplying them with trade goods and arms because they needed a counterweight to the United States in the event of war. And the British, in time of peace, tried to keep their Indians peaceful. But the Indians often had their own agenda. They didn't care what the British wanted to do. They had their grievances against the United States, and they responded by raiding on the American frontier. Americans didn't understand that. Two things Americans didn't understand about those Indian depredations in the old Northwest. Number one, we and we alone were responsible for those depredations because of our increasingly aggressive policy of imposing treaties on the Indians to get their lands. Those treaties were imposed on the Indians between 1800 and 1809 by William Henry Harrison, who was the governor of Indiana Territory and our Indian agent. And what really pushed the Indians over the edge was the treaty negotiated in 1809, by which essentially what Harrison did was he rounded up a few compliant Indians, got them drunk, had them sign on the dotted line, and surrender territory that they didn't even live in. I mean, this was a fraud. That was the Treaty of Fort Wayne. And I've forgotten how much land those Indians surrendered that they had no title to, but it was a couple of million acres. And that's really what pushed, I think, the militant Indians, particularly Tecumseh and the Prophet, sort of into the British camp after 1809. So that was a minor cause of the war, but I don't think that would have brought on the war in and of itself. And then there was the issue of national honor. Some guy in the 1960s wrote an article that the primary reason we went to war in 1812 was to vindicate national honor. Okay. Well, what threatened national honor? It was those maritime issues, mainly. So it seems to me that is simply an extension of the maritime causes. There was also a widely held Republican view that if we didn't defend our rights, our entire Republican experiment would collapse, our experiment in representative government. And bear in mind, we were the only Republican in the Western world at that time. And it was believed if the lamp of liberty was ever snuffed out here, it might never be rekindled. So we carried the hopes of mankind. And if we couldn't defend our own rights on the high seas, then the American people might become disillusioned with representative government and opt for, you know, some kind of authoritarian government, a monarchy. Well, that's a fair argument, but what were the practices that threatened the Republican experiment? They were maritime issues. So you peel back that top layer, you're still looking at the orders in council and impressment. There was another issue here, the political issue. Republicans went to war in 1812 in part for domestic political reasons. Their party was fragmented, they were facing a presidential election, and they found Federalist opposition to their foreign policy of trade restrictions increasingly annoying and hard to counter. And so you find Republicans telling one another, if we go to war in 1812, we will unify our party, we will silence the opposition, and we will guarantee that we will remain in power in Washington. In other words, Republican leaders were thinking like the leaders of a banana republic. Let's go to war to keep power. Now, that's a minor cause. And even there, you peel back the top layer. Why is their party fragmented? Why is there so much opposition? Well, it's all because of the maritime issues. So it looks to me like the maritime issues, particularly the orders in council and impressment, are the two leading causes of the War of 1812. Okay? All right, Madison played a significant and probably underappreciated role in the coming of this war. Madison was not a strong war leader. He was shy, retiring. He was only 5'4". His enemies called him Little Jemmy. And he was not really a forceful leader. Nevertheless, he did three things to help bring on the War of 1812. He summoned Congress to an earlier than normal meeting on November 4th, 1812. And in his opening address to Congress the next day, he asked for war preparations. He asked Congress to put the nation into an armor and an attitude demanded by the crisis. And then in March, he submitted a series of documents to Congress that purported to show that the British had a spy, a guy named John Henry, in New England in 1808, 1809, stirring up opposition and treason. He thought that would stimulate support for war. It didn't. And then on June 1st, 1812, he submitted a secret message to Congress. Madison was too much of a constitutionalist to ask Congress for a declaration of war. What that message on June 12th simply did was lay out all our grievances against Great Britain. And by the way, the tone of that message is pretty angry. I didn't really realize that until I reread it a year or so ago. And Madison lays out the case for war, says we are in a state of peace with Great Britain. Great Britain is in a state of war with us. Congress may now wish to consider what to do. So for all practical purposes, Madison is asking Congress to declare war, but not quite explicitly. Now, without Madison taking the lead, particularly in asking for war preparations and then asking for a declaration of war, I doubt there would have been one. But also important was the role of the War Hawks. There were about a dozen young members of Congress, too young to remember the horrors of the last British war, and eager to vindicate American sovereignty on the high seas and prepared to go to war. The most important of these was Henry Clay, a first-term congressman from Kentucky who was elected to the ceremonial post of Speaker of the House and very quickly transformed that ceremonial position into a position of real power. He packed the key committees with other war hawks. He interpreted the rules of the House of Representatives in a way that was favorable to the war movement. He controlled debate on the key issues. And in effect, by using the powers that he had endowed in the speakership, he kept the war movement on track. Without Madison, there would have been no declaration of war. Without the war hawks, I don't think there would have been one either. Now, Madison submitted his war message to Congress in secret on June 1st, 1812. It sped through the House pretty quickly, about 3 days, because the Federalists, who were prepared with long speeches in opposition to it, refused to conduct that debate in secret. So they remained silent. Nevertheless, the vote in the House of Representatives was pretty close, 79-49. The bill was then sent up to the Senate. The Senate spent 2 weeks on the bill, and at one point, it came very close to amending the bill to limit it to reprisals on the high seas targeting both the French and the British. At one point, there was a vote in the Senate to send the House bill back to committee and to amend it with these changes. So we would have ended up with a limited maritime war that targeted both the British and the French. But when that amended bill came out of committee, the regular Republicans mustered a couple of extra votes and voted down that amended bill. And the way they voted it down was, it was actually one more vote in favor of the amended bill than against it, but the acting presiding officer in the Senate then cast his vote against it. So that made it a tie vote, and under the rules, if any bill received a tie vote, it was a defeat. So with that, the original bill was restored, and it passed the Senate by a vote of 19-13. 79-49 in the House of Representatives, 19-13 in the Senate. This is the closest vote on any declaration of war in American history. We've only had 11 formal declarations of war. War of 1812, Mexican War, Spanish-American War. Then there were two in World War I against Germany and the Austrian Empire, and something like eight in World War II initially against Germany, Japan, and Italy, and then there were, I think, three lesser declarations of war in early 1942 against countries in the Balkans. I guess that's only six in World War II. Six in World War II, two in World War I, that's eight, and then the other three are 1812, 1846, and 1898. We don't declare war anymore. Well, the way we do it now is Congress authorizes the president to take military action if he thinks it's justified. The upside of that is you keep all of your options open and you can surprise an enemy, as we did in the first Gulf War. The downside is you don't have a clear, bright line between war and peace. And you have members of Congress who can vote to give the president military action, and then he does it and they say, no, that's not what I had in mind. Include me out. Question here.
Yeah, I mean, I think we should look back. I think we should reconsider where the other issues factor in the causes of the march to war. I think in light of what you just described, because there may be reasons to go to war, and all the maritime reasons seem to be very strong arguments for why we have legitimate grievances against the British. But if war is a political process, and what is going to be the cost to overcoming this resistance for war, if after all these years of grievances with the British and the Federalists in New England, who have the most to presumably win from freer trade, if they even are reluctant to go to war, and the vote in Congress is so close, what's in it for somebody like Henry Clay to push for the war? And I think, you know, if he's from Kentucky, you mentioned William Henry Harrison and the treaties with the Native Americans. I think that perhaps the grievances against Britain are the reason, but the political impetus is something that is not happening east, it's happening west. Those two things together then perhaps create the perfect formula to bring those last few votes along and get the declaration of war. But it doesn't seem that you can have one without the other. You really need both. So I would really think that the so-called other issues that are minor are major from the political point of view, not from the actual reasonable point of view, if that makes any sense.
All right, well, I don't buy that argument. And there are a couple of reasons for this. Number one, Henry Clay himself, the leading war hawk, said in 1813, Canada was not the end of this war. It was the means to secure the redress of other injuries, the maritime issues. Well, I also believe, in general, people say what they mean. Now, I was talking to a guy who was in the security business a couple days ago at Sackett's Harbor. I delivered a lecture on the War of 1812. And he was basically making that argument. Oh, you can't believe what people say. Well, I think in general, people say what they mean. And if they don't, then you might as well forget about writing serious history. And you could say anything. You say, well, what they really wanted to do was conquer Canada because our final objective was to seize the moon. But you couldn't actually make that case to the American people, so nobody made mention of the moon. But that's my belief as to why we went to war. Now, there's more to this argument. There are two compelling reasons, at least I find them compelling, why we went to war, primarily over the orders in council and impressment. Number one, those two issues dominated the debate in Congress and in the newspapers, not only in the East, but also in the West. Westerners were furious with the orders in council because they blamed an agricultural depression on the loss of their foreign markets. So you find Westerners who do not engage in trade, but they are dependent on foreign markets, complaining about the orders in council. Number two, Madison sends out peace feelers within a week of the declaration of war, and he tells the British they can have peace if they give up the orders in council and impressment. And then 6 weeks later, when we learn the British have repealed the orders, 5 days after we declared war, Madison renews the plea and says, now you can have peace if you give up impressment. He did not say you can have peace if you give up impressment and give us Canada, or call off your Indian allies. The only issues raised here were the orders in council and impressment. And that, to me, is compelling and decisive evidence that those were the two leading causes of the war. And it seems to me they dominated the public debate in the run-up to the war, and that solidifies the case. Now, we'll take your counterpoint if you have one.
I'm not suggesting that the Westerners are looking to conquer Canada. There's other things, just actually controlling our own borderlands territories, getting Kentucky and the territories of Ohio that had just become a new state, getting those areas pacified and really opening trade up and down the Mississippi. The borderlands in the West, they're not engaging in trade. They're engaging in trade within themselves in the Great Lakes, which are dominated by the British and the natives, and along the Mississippi. Surely the interest in having commerce in the East will impact the overall economic well-being of the nation, and we make our revenue from tariffs. So again, I'm not discounting the reasons in the East, but in the West, and again, I'm not talking about conquering Canada. I mean, after all, we walk into Upper Canada where all the loyalists have gone and we got kicked out of there. But it's not about conquering Canada, but really securing that all Northwest, which now has become settled land by Americans. And so to the conflict with the Native Americans that was developing in the West, figuring as the reason for somebody like Henry Clay, what's in it for a Kentuckian member of the House to go to war over questions in the East? Again, those are reasons to go to war. And by the way, when I say that I don't, that that's what he said, I'm not saying that we cannot believe what people say, although we cannot write history, but we know we have a Gulf of Tonkin resolution. We've had all kinds of pretexts of the spot resolutions to go over the Mexican War. We've had the Iraq War. We have all kinds of complicated reasons for why we may, what we may tell the public convince them that perhaps legitimate reasons, together with political reasons, get us to where we want to go.
Do you think in 1812 we would go to war if the British were not committing these encroachments on our rights on the high seas?
No, I'm not. Again, I'm not saying that we would have gone to war if those reasons were not there. What I'm saying is that if those reasons in the East being there, together with the political impetus that somebody like Henry Clay would have from the West, those two come together to provide the political reason and the economic reasons to get us to war. To say that we're going to go to war, I mean, that the traders in the New England, I mean, why would the people in New England would oppose war? They have the most to lose, so to speak, because they are the ones that are in the trade. Sure, we also have agricultural products that are for trade in the South. But if we think about who is supporting going to war with Britain, it's the West and the South. The Northeast, which in some ways should be the most on board with this war, they're holding back.
A lot of the votes for war came from the middle states. New York, Pennsylvania, and in those days, Maryland and Delaware were kind of considered middle states.
No, but I mean, I'm not disputing the maritime reasons
I'm not disputing that the issues you're raising were minor causes of the war. We're talking about primacy here.
I guess my point is that I would move them up and put them a little bit more higher in the scale, but that's, right. We'll continue the conversation.
Honest men can differ, honest scholars can disagree on that, and there are serious scholars who have made an argument similar to yours. But I find the evidence pretty compelling that the maritime issues were primary. But this is contentious issue, and there isn't a clear right or wrong answer. There are just strongly held beliefs. All right, now, finally I want to ask, here we are, we go to war in 1812. It looks to me like there's some serious problems with this decision to go to war. Number one, we're taking on one of the two most powerful nations in the world. And number two, the greatest naval power in the world, mistress of the seas. The only nation that can blockade our coast and destroy our trade. So a pretty formidable enemy. Number two, the nation is wholly unprepared for war. We adopted war preparations between December of 1811 and April of 1812. Those war preparations had been made on paper, but they were a long way from having matured. Republicans were aware of this. As one Republican, a guy named Robert Wright, put it at the time in the sort of colorful language, we're getting married and buying the furniture afterwards. In other words, we're going to war, and then we will we'll worry about the preparations. And number three, we were going to war against the express opposition of upwards of 40% of the American people, at least based on that vote in Congress. So here we are taking on a formidable foe with a huge navy that can raid our coast, destroy our commerce, blockade our coastline, with the United States unprepared, and against significant domestic opposition. This does not look to me like a great decision. So I've wrestled with why Republicans were willing to take this very risky step, because that's what it was. And I think the answer is this. Number one, they hoped no fighting would be necessary. You find Republicans talking to one another in 1812 and saying the British aren't taking it seriously. They don't realize how angry we were. A declaration of war will bring them to their senses. In other words, they will make concessions based on the declaration of war itself. And I think Madison shared that view. That's why he sent out peace feelers within a week. By the way, the British found that puzzling. They understood that when you were at war, you might talk peace, but typically they thought there was an important intervening step. You had to whip the other guy first. And we seem to have left out that step. So they hoped that no fighting would be necessary, and if it was, they assumed we could easily conquer Canada. We had a huge population advantage. That 500,000 people living in Canada included the French population, which wasn't likely to lay its lives on the line for the British. And also, recent American immigrants. After 1792, there was a flood of Americans into Canada to take advantage of free land and low taxes. The British officials optimistically called those immigrants the late loyalists, as if they would be every bit as fiercely loyal to Great Britain as the original Revolutionary War loyalists were. Republicans expected the conquest of Canada to be a cakewalk, and there wouldn't be anything the British could do about it because they were tied up in Europe. So that, I believe, is why they're willing to take this very risky step. Okay? None of this played out like the British thought it would, as we shall see. Yes?
How exactly could the Democrat Republicans reconcile, because obviously you have to assume to a certain degree, what if the British actually do take the declaration of war seriously? Given that, how would they be able to reconcile their whole philosophy of they didn't want to spend the money to build an army, they didn't want to have a standing navy and so forth, like the Federalists did? How could they reconcile that?
Well, a couple of comments here. Number one, they were pretty optimistic about the outcome of this war, and that often happens. Nations at the beginning of the war are confident, they can whip the other guy pretty quickly. And it doesn't often play out that way. It isn't as if the Jeffersonian Republicans were not complete pacifists. Most Americans thought Republicans were more peace-loving than the monarchies of Europe, and that most Americans opposed war. You needed a very good reason to go to war. And that gave Federalist opponents of this war some leverage with the public. But almost all Americans, there were a few really hardcore pacifists. Sid Hart's going to talk about an artist family. They did not believe in war. I think it's Sid. Maybe it's one of our other speakers. But most Americans believed war on occasion was justified. So the issue in 1812 was war justified against Great Britain in 1812. Republicans thought it was, Federalists thought it wasn't. And then the related issue was war going to produce any good? Republicans thought it would win recognition of our maritime rights. Federalists thought they were dreaming, we would not achieve our war aims, and Federalists were vindicated. We can take one more question here, and then we got to wrap it up.
I just read recently a book on Andrew Jackson, and it discussed this that right before shortly before the declaration of war, there was an attack by a British ship on our coast that killed. Do you know the incident
you're thinking
I'm talking
of the
about?
Chesapeake Affair. That was 5 years before the Declaration of War.
Oh, wait, 5 years.
June 1807, a British warship stopped an American warship on the high seas, demanded the right to muster the crew to remove 4 deserters. This was normally a nation's warships were considered an extension of its sovereignty, so this was unusual. And when our commander would not allow the British to board the ship, the British unloaded and killed and wounded a number of the crew members and then removed the 4 deserters. That festered in Anglo-American relations for 4 years, but in November of 1811, 7 months before the declaration of war, the two sides resolved that issue. So the Chesapeake Affair, although it was a reflection of the larger problem of impressment, was not a cause of the War of 1812.
It's called the Chesapeake Affair.
Yeah. I think we're out of time. We can pick up some of these themes a little bit later. Thank you very much.